This is a gentle reminder to our participants to mute audio and keep the video off for the session. Good evening. I, Prajakta Adhikari, on behalf of the Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research, warmly welcomes all our participants and our speakers for today. The Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research, IEAR, which is a Mumbai-based educational research and training institute with a vision to create a sustainable environment through scientific research, education and training, socio-cultural understanding, community engagement and awareness. We are a multidisciplinary group of scientists, professionals and academicians who have joined forces to form this organization, having worked collaboratively for more than 15 years on education, environment consultancy and awareness. Our mission is environment first. This is the 18th webinar in the series, which we started during the lockdown period. So far, we have reached out to more than 2,500 participants altogether. Our main objective in this webinar series is to provide educational and research inputs and a scientific and analytical approach to environmental issues. Today's program is being conducted on the eve of Women's Day. Our flow of the webinar will be as follows. Firstly, the introduction. Secondly, the introduction of the program and the panelist by our moderator, Dr. Roshni Yehuda. The discussion with the panelist, the audience questions, and the announcement of the Women Leaders in Sustainability Award. And later, the vote of thanks and closing remarks again by me. I would now welcome Dr. Roshni Yehuda, President of IEAR, to introduce our today's webinar and our speakers. Over to you, Dr. Roshni.
Good evening and a warm welcome to our six fabulous guests here who are there with us today to celebrate the International Women's Day. To all the people who are watching this program and to women everywhere, greetings of the International Women's Day, which is observed every year on 8th March to celebrate and recognize the social, environmental, economic, cultural, and political achievements of women and their contribution. At the Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research, we decided to celebrate this day with the theme of Women in Environment and dedicated to outstanding women who in their own fields have contributed immensely to environmental protection and conservation. I am indeed fortunate to have been acquainted with each one of the guests here today. And in fact, we have even worked together with some of you for nearly two decades. So today's program is dedicated to you, the shining stars in our galaxy, who have followed their heart, stood up for what they thought right, and work relentlessly, no matter what, for the conservation and protection of environment. And most importantly, you have inspired hundreds and maybe thousands of others who have taken you as their guide. So I warmly welcome each and every one of you to the program today on Women in Environment. Before I go ahead with the introductions and the first round, I would like to briefly talk about the theme, that is Women in Environment. Some women have inspired us all and have left a mark in our lives. To name a few, Rachel Carson, Donella Meadows, Jane Jacobs, at a global scale, they have voiced their opinions against the destruction of environment. They have stood the might of even powerful corporations and supported science and their belief in environment. They have embraced nature and shown us the path. Then we have women like Jane Goodall, who's a living testimony of a scientist dedicated to saving the chimpanzees. And there are many, many more. And now we have the younger generation like Greta Thunberg and many others. In India too, we have names such as Sunita Narayan, the director of CSC, Center for Science Environment, Sumaira Abdulali, who has relentlessly worked to create awareness and legislation against noise pollution and sand mining, and many others who have espoused causes such as wildlife protection, river restoration, non-chemical and non-GM crops, air pollution, and even open spaces. Yes, people like Naina Katpalia in Mumbai, because of whom we still have the Oval Maidan and other open spaces intact in the city of Mumbai. I'm sure that such examples are everywhere in Africa, in Nepal, in Germany, in United States, and in Israel. These are the countries from where our panelists are here today. I mean, it's amazing that this online mode allows us to come together from so many different parts of the world. And there are many whose names will never be known. And I want to dedicate this program to them as well. There are many people who are silently doing a lot more for protection and conservation of the environment. It's important to have somebody to look up to. And that is why we have all of you here. So let me start off the first round of discussion by introducing each one of you and also hearing your story, your motivation, your inspirations, and what keeps you engaged at this very point of time. So first up is Dr. Anne Rademacher. We have been fortunate to have interacted with her. I have personally interacted with her for, I think, maybe 15 years or so. We've visited with our students, many study tours and so on, have heard her lectures where she talks passionately and energetically about her favorite subject, that is ecology and environment. So Dr. Anne Rademacher is professor of environmental studies at New York University. Her research explores the political and cultural dimensions of sustainability in cities through ethnographic analysis of urban environmental change. She studies how place-based affinities, contested histories and ideologies of belonging develop in struggles over the form, content and quality of urban environments. Anne's focus has been urban ecology and its scientific contours, its application across cultural and political contexts, and its interconnection with social change. She has authored many books, and some of these include Reining the River, Urban Ecologies and Political Transformation in Kathmandu. I believe Anne has spent nearly 12 years doing her research on the Bagmati River in Kathmandu. Building Green Environmental Architects and the Struggle for Sustainability in Mumbai, and with K. Shivaramakrishnan, Ecologies of Urbanism in India, Places of Nature in Ecologies of Urbanism, and a forthcoming book, Death and Life of Nature in Asian Cities. And it's a pleasure to have you with us. Do enlighten us about your work in the past, what inspired or inspires you, and what you're currently doing. And over to you.
Thank you so much, Roshni, and thank you to all of you for warmly inviting me to join such an inspiring group of women, such an inspiring group of people committed to environmental protection and to caring not just for our natural world, but in doing so, caring for one another. I wish you all a very, very happy International Women's Day. I'm speaking to all of you from New York City, where it's early morning, and as is true of our Zoom reality, I am in front of a window which is in front of a very busy New York street. And so you may hear in the background, punctuating my remarks, periodic sounds of the nature just outside my window, which is the nature of the city, the nature of New York. But this morning, I suppose we are gathered not just to reflect on what it is that has inspired us and continues to inspire us to work towards the protection of a natural world that, even as we work, we watch it falling away in so many ways. We also gather to listen to, as Roshni has said, listen to what inspires us. Why? Not just to tell it out loud, but maybe in sharing our stories to give one another energy. We're at the at least the end is in sight, I hope, of a year or more of global pandemic time, right? This time has reminded all of us how deeply connected our human family is with that natural world. We've spent much time detached from one another and detached from the kind of mobility we might have enjoyed before the pandemic began. For me, that mobility allowed me to connect literally to other geographies, other natural landscapes that give me a lot of nourishment and continue to inspire me, but also the presence of other people. I'm grateful for Zoom for bringing us all together, but at the same time, mindful that the presence that Zoom allows is a very different kind of presence than the presence in person. So I hope that my remarks today will contribute a little bit to sustaining our energy for one another and also for ourselves to continue to get through this very difficult period. My hope is that everyone joining us has made it through this time and continues to feel both the urgency of environmental protection, but also the urgency of being with one another. So it's a pleasure to be with you. What do I do? What is my work? And I'll keep it very brief. All of us have very little time to try to encapsulate what is probably for all of us a big story of inspiration. And so I'll tell it to you maybe following Roshni's reminder of some of the great towering figures, women who inspired many of us to have a look at the complexity of the natural world to begin with. The first name that she mentioned was Rachel Carson. And Rachel Carson grew up on a river that many years later, I would also grow up along. I grew up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. This is a city in southwestern Pennsylvania in the US that is punctuated by the convergence of three rivers. So I grew up watching rivers, thinking about rivers, inspired by the majesty of rivers, and then curious about the natural landscape around rivers. By growing up along this confluence of rivers, I had a vision in mind of what a healthy river looked like and also what a polluted river might have looked like, because the history of Pittsburgh is like the history of many cities in the Northeast section of North America. It was very much an industrial landscape. It was very much a river used for transport, used for as a kind of repository as the city modernized and as we say in older speak, advanced. We know now that that advancement also involved an awful lot of damage to our climate and to the natural world. Nevertheless, what was once a polluted river, by the time I was growing up along it, had a great story that came with it of river restoration, a river revived and with it, a city revitalized and reinvented. So I became fascinated by rivers. I started to study the natural history of rivers, the hydrology, the natural science of them, and became, like many of us who become interested in the natural world, dedicated to the sciences of ecosystem ecology, the interconnections of the sciences that help us understand how nature works, how it changes. Why? Because I wanted to be able to affect that story of environmental improvement in other places. I wanted to know that other systems that were degraded, other ecologies that were suffering, could be made whole again, could be restored again. And so I studied ecosystem ecology. I did all of my work in the natural sciences and learned to diagnose a polluted river, a damaged river, through the tools of science. And then I did what I thought I was supposed to do to make environmental change. I went to other river systems in the world and said, I know what to do. I will do these ecological diagnoses and write this ecological prescription, and we'll bring that river back to life. Well, Roshni told you that one of the first major research projects that I did was along the Bagmati River in Kathmandu. A river that, from a scientific point of view, when I first became acquainted with it, yes, was a very polluted river. But that wasn't the only part of the story, of course. Rivers, just like any part of the natural world, are also places where people made meanings and lived histories over the period of the history of their acquaintance with those systems. And by coming to know the Bhagmati, I also came to know an incredibly culturally rich place, a place of history, a place of politics, a place of contest over what kind of development should happen along that riverscape. And I found myself as a scientist completely confounded, because the things that would drive river protection or river degradation seem to have so little to do with the science and so much to do with human interaction, human dignity, human hearing of stories and understanding of one another. And so if I were to tell you that my inspiration to study and work toward environmental protection started with rivers, I would also need to tell you that the real effective work that I've done has always depended on building bridges. And I don't mean physical bridges. I mean the bridges that are the sort that connect us, not just with people familiar to us, worldviews we know, languages we're born speaking, cultural orientations that are comfortable, but bridges into the social worlds that are most unfamiliar to us, most sometimes scary because we cannot understand them, most confusing because they seem so opposite to the worldview that we are accustomed to. I want to celebrate today for International Women's Day a woman who made all of my work in Nepal, which spanned two decades, possible. She was not a scientist. She was not a recognized champion of any kind of environmental protection. She was not known outside of her family and her immediate neighborhood. But she built the single bridge that made it possible for me to do all of the work that I've been able to do in my career since then. And I just got my 8-minute timer to go off, so I'm concluding. Her name is Manju Pradhan. Wow. I came to know her as Manju Ama. Mm-hmm. She was the woman in my host family in Nepal who brought me in before I could speak Nepali, before I knew anything about that cultural landscape that I would later have to learn about in order to write and work on the Bhagmati River and all the rivers I've worked on since then. And so my tribute, my inspiration, is not to a recognized great woman, but to that woman that made it possible for me by building a bridge between an English-speaking scientist and a complex cultural world that it would take me decades to understand and write about. This morning, I dedicate my gathering and my wish to all of you a happy International Women's Day to the memory of Manju Pradhan, who we lost to this pandemic, but whose memory and whose light is with me and with all of us whose lives she touched. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anne, for giving us that inspiring story. And it was really, really touching. I am going to go to the next speaker. Next panelist, a very dynamic. Just a second, I have the yes. We have a very young, dynamic wildlife lover and teacher, Sanjeevani Yonjon Shrestha. And I think there's a connection from the last speaker to this one, because Sanjeevani is from Nepal. And that's where Anne has spent a lot of her time doing research on the Bhagmati River. Sanjeevani and my acquaintance go back to almost 12 years, I think. But I have known her for a very long time, and her work is simply amazing. Sanjeevani is a well-known environmentalist and director of the Wildlife Conservation Nepal. Her career spans a little over 20 years as a conservationist, educator, writer, and a humanitarian responder. She has a master's degree in environmental science from Tribhuvan University and she's pursuing a degree in pedagogy. She's especially committed to engaging with communities and people from all walks of life in nature conservation, and is working to transform the way environmental education is taught in Nepal. She has co-written more than 20 different books for children and teachers, several lesson plans and curricula on environment. She's a US Embassy's International Visitor Leadership Program Fellow, and currently she is leading the Green School Movement with her team. Sanjeevani is a passionate advocate of circular economy, and she's also involved in developing community-based innovative solutions to mitigate the repercussions of climate change, create viable local business solutions to tackle such issues with her team and different partners. In the past few years, Sanjeevani has developed and implemented educational and advocacy programs and projects on wildlife conservation, waste management, climate change, and natural resource management in coordination with different stakeholders and different levels of government of Nepal. Let's hear from Sanjeevani. Over to you, Sanjeevani.
Thank you, Roshni. Namaste, everybody. It's an honor and a great pleasure to be here with you all. I would not say no to anything Roshni would offer me, because she herself is an inspiring person that I've been so lucky to have met during the IVLP program in the US 12 years ago. Following up on the previous speaker, I was overwhelmed with her experience in Nepal, and I would just like to say thank you, because the Bagmati River is like the shining silver line of hope in our capital. And even though what we really want is a clean Bagmati, a lot of hands have gone through, gone to making it a live river, and it's still a work in progress. So I would like to thank her on behalf of all the Nepalese as well. Wildlife Conservation Nepal is a very small homegrown Nepali NGO, and I've grown with the organization. I joined it when I was a young girl, and we were so hell-bent on changing the way we realized that we must change how we teach younger children on environment, and not in the disconnected way that we were being taught in our classes. So what we started in our organization is not only to talk about and work on big conservation projects with rhinos, tigers, and elephants, but along with it also to work with people, to work a little bit beyond the awareness aspect. Because what we realized was the education projects or the education movement that we had until then was only about, making campaign rallies, talking about conservation during Conservation Day, and making poetry. Of course, that is important, but we realized there was a whole lot of changes that we needed to make in the education system also. So that's how my journey with wildlife conservation started, to work alongside big conservation projects, but by making room for interactive environmental education that goes a little bit beyond just talking about conservation, but also inculcating the values of conservation in the way we live our lives. We were a group of friends who joined WCN or Wildlife Conservation as volunteers. What we designed was a very interactive environmental education program. We were shooed and brushed aside by sector leaders back then, thinking what are these girls and boys up to?
But 20 years down the line, there have been serious changes in the environmental education program in Nepal. And we've had, we may not have become like huge economic or a huge success in that manner, but we have been successful in institutionalizing the environmental component in the education system. Today, the same group of friends, of course, new members. With new members, we are poised, ready to launch the first eco center in Nepal in Kathmandu, where we envision that all children from Nepal across the country can come and learn and make new connections with nature. Probably children from all over the world can also join. So this is we are on the cusp of doing something a little bit crazy, but this is like very exciting time for us. And yes, we're working with municipalities. Like Nepal has just we transitioned into a federal country. So there's a lot of changes at political and at government level. And our work is affecting positively in those systems as well, because the municipalities are now working with local curriculums, precedents set by our program. So yeah, these are the few things. And what inspires me is actually the promise of a better world that we can really create. I just feel like it's within our grasp. And if we can just like make, if we can just move an inch further, we can just touch it. So this is what I feel. And this is what inspires me every single day to do the work that I do. And yeah, I would just like to wish everybody a very happy International Women's Day, and celebrate all of your successes and also your struggles and challenges that you have faced. Because I'm sure, like, no matter what our backgrounds, we've had our challenges, common challenges as well. So thank you so much. This is it for now.
Thank you, Sanjeevani. She has been really modest. I know that her team and has been working round the clock. I get so much news about their work that they're doing to protect the wildlife, and especially their contribution to education is really very, very significant. And I do hope that you can influence the government in Nepal, which I'm sure you're already doing, and I hope you can do that around the world as well. So that was a wonderful, inspiring piece from Sanjeevani. And I will just read out the next bio of Chembo, Chembo Sichinga, if I'm correct. She's a technical expert in renewable energy, one who speaks from her heart, and who is a passionate musician and dancer. Mrs. Chembo Mutwale Sichinga holds a Bachelor of Engineering in Chemical Engineering from the Copperbelt University in Zambia. She also holds a Master of Engineering degree in Renewable Energy Engineering from the University of Zambia. A wife and a mother of two, Chembo has worked in various capacities spanning her career of just over a decade, 9 years of which were in the environmental sector. Currently, she serves as acting manager, renewable energy at the Energy Regulation Board in Zambia. Chembo is passionate about fashion, home decor, and Afrobeats music. And before I introduce, I ask her to speak, let me tell you that I met her maybe 2 years ago at the International Mashav program. And she is very strong in her field and doing lots of things in her country. So over to you, Chembo. Let's hear it from you.
Okay. Thank you, Roshni. Greetings, everybody from across the world. As has already been said, my names are Chembo Mutwale Sichinga, from Zambia, Africa. So I'm currently serving as acting manager renewable energy at the Energy Regulation Board here in Zambia. So my job basically entails provision of regulatory oversight over the renewable energy subsector And of course, this is through planned, unplanned activities that may come along during the year. As was mentioned, I hold a Bachelor of Engineering degree in Chemical Engineering and a Master of Engineering in Renewable Energy Engineering. Currently serving in the energy sector, but before that, of course, I served in the environmental sector. And of course, you know, growing up, going into probably what motivates me, growing up, there was a tagline by a certain cable company that broadcasts across Africa, and it was so much more. So this tagline, you know, growing up, it resonated with me so much because then for me, I believed for me to get my so much more, I needed to work hard. And that was basic. I just needed to work hard to get my so much more. So over and above, I'm motivated by hard work. I'm motivated by all-roundedness. I'm motivated by people who push, you know, to make it work. And, you know, when I talk of hard work, it's not hard work, you know, in academics. It's not anything professional, but it's something prudent that gets you by. So hard work for me just does it. And also for people who have a balance in life, I think for me, striking a good balance in life is always very encouraging and motivating. And also, you know, as the days unfold, as years unfold, seeing things get done at the office and all other aspects of my life gives me the drive to push and obviously know that I can still achieve more looking at what has been done so far in all areas of my life. I mean, certain times we're all faced with various challenges. It's in our places of work, there are situations that actually need you to sit long hours and see how to go about them. But all these things getting done over the years has really just given me the drive to go on and on. And I recently joined a mentorship group to just bring up, it's a mentorship group for girls in science. And I joined this one because for me, I think I remember myself, you know, back in school, not being too sure. Yes, you're an engineering student, but certain times you actually don't know where you end up. You don't know, you know, you really have no contacts. You don't know, you really just don't know your way around things. And you know, you don't know how things will unfold going forward. So I joined this group, I think just slightly over 3 weeks ago, to help groom more students. And currently I have a young lady, civil and environmental engineer from the University of Zambia right here. And I'm grooming her, she's in her third year and I wish her the very best. And yeah, for now that's it. So happy Women's Day to everybody and thank you Roshni once again.
Thank you Che, that's how we used to call her. She actually showed us so many things about Africa and she, you know, songs and music. And so thank you so much for that overall sort of input from Zambia, I would say. And she's got a very important role now as, you know, the leading this renewable energy, which is very, very important all over the world. And it's not very easy, I should say, to lead such a big program. So at a very young age, he has taken it up. All the very best to you, Che. So, and now I move on to our next speaker. Our next panelist is Anjali Butner, an engineer who believes in green and blue infrastructure. Anjali is a practicing engineer and planner working with Clima Connection since 1994, working primarily on green spaces and infrastructure, landscape architectures, stormwater management, and sponge cities. She's also a lecturer on water management, engineering, ecology, and green infrastructure at the Duke University since March of last year, and deputy professor in landscape architecture and green space management at the University of Applied Sciences in New Brandenburg, Germany. She has been involved in some prestigious international projects as expert landscape architect in Vietnam and also AquaNet in Brandenburg. She was associate partner in Plan Resort Berlin from 2005 to 2011. And prior to that, CEO of Butner Office, Garden and Landscape Planning. Among other important positions, he has worked with the municipality of Berlin as leader of the Environmental Agency and Department of Parks. Over to you, Anjali. I think we would love to hear from you. Anjali, are you
thank
there?
You. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Thank you. Thank you, Roshni. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you to see all of you. Thank of seeing the women on Women's Day. I'm always for equality, so I'm also greeting the gentlemen today, which are taking part in this event. And it's a big pleasure for me to speak about what is motivating me, or what was and is motivating me. So actually, when I think back, it started with the garden of my mom, because she had a little garden, and I started to love the little flowers and the smell and the taste of the strawberries and all of that. And this was growing in my heart, and it grew up to a profession. So I started to become a landscape planner. And it was always the pleasure about creating something. I always loved and liked to draw and to paint. I'm still painting and also doing sculptures. This is what Chenbo spoke about the balance in life. So this is very important for me, this balance. Actually, I started in Berlin in different positions as an employee. And then I decided already in 1994, as you told Roshni, I started with my own office, planning office. I started on a very small scale. I had two kids, and I was educating them alone. I was separated from my father for some reason. This happens sometimes. I think some of you know that. And so it was a little bit crazy looking back. I was really crazy to do that, because I had no money. I had nothing. My parents were really far away, so quite 300 kilometers. But I did my own thing because I wanted to create new places. And I started in Berlin with the courtyards. Berlin is quite crowded, and we have a structure of the buildings which create courtyards. And these courtyards, the houses were built in 1870, and they were really, these courtyards were really empty, tough, really crowded, and they were covered with concrete, mostly covered with concrete, no green, sometimes one tree in the middle, but nothing else. And this was my first challenge to create green spaces in the courtyards of Berlin. This was my start. Then I went over to schoolyards. I went over to kindergartens, sporting places, playgrounds. So all of the green stuff you can create newly, or you can change. Yeah, you can change something. You have to consider which are the existing trees, for instance, the existing infrastructures, and so on. And I did all of that in planning and in construction site management. So I was always outside, and I loved it because I love nature and to be outside. And I really worked with the pipelines and the shafts and the soil and the buggers and all of the machines, and not myself, but as a construction site manager. So my aim, or what makes me really going forward, is to think about first about ecology. This was from the beginning on, to plan ecological projects. Then later, it changed into climate change. Actually, in Berlin, we were in a quite comfortable situation. Till, I would say, 3 years before, the people of Berlin didn't really feel and experience what climate change means. But then the hot summer started. We had really hot summers. We had, I remember in, I think it was August 2019, we had 39 degrees in Berlin. 39 degrees, it was terribly hot.
My God.
Unbelievable. And then everybody started to hear, oh, is it this climate change? Maybe, yeah. Scientists tell us it's climate change, but yeah, who knows? But then the next summer came. So the first one, 2018, second one, 2019. Last summer was also very hot. And so we have a huge challenge. And this makes me quite unquiet. I feel I can't find a quietness. Do you understand what I mean? I feel we have to do all we can in this moment. In this moment, we can't wait anymore. We can't wait any more second. We have to plant trees. We have to change all the world into a green world, and we have to change our behavior. So this makes me to always going on in my work, and I also love to bring my experiences and my knowledge and also my emphasis to the young people, to the students. And I really love it to discuss with them, to see they are really open, they want to learn, they want to do something. And this brings a big pleasure to me. And so, yeah, this is my reason to work and to go forward and forward in the green and blue thing, because I'm doing the water management already also from 1996. I started with the rainwater project in these years, and I never studied that. I learned it all by myself. I read a lot of books, and I did things I thought I would never do because I wasn't as good in mathematics as it is usable or necessary. And so I started to work with the mathematic formulas to create the first rainwater management projects. And it worked. And so the blue and the green both are in my heart and in my work. Thank you. That's all. And I wish all of us a very nice Women's Day.
Thanks, Anjali. That was so from the heart and inspiring. I think you started with your mother, and that's where I think everybody's childhood, it all comes back to that. So your mother's garden probably was the inspiration. But what you're doing in practice is really wonderful, because we can all speak a lot, but it means a lot to do something on the ground. And as you say, we don't have time, and we need to use every movement to do something about the environment. So that's a very inspiring thought and action for all of us. Let me go on to the next speaker. Professor Ruthie Cantor. I'm amazed at the different levels of people from different areas that we have got. Ruthie is a visual communication designer from Israel. And I think our work together goes back to maybe 2015 when we met. And ever since, every year, our team, as in also other people like Elad Perso, have organized successfully an international interdisciplinary workshop in India and in Israel called Small is Beautiful. And that's a success that has worked on for the last at least 4 years successively. So Professor Ruthie Cantor is a senior lecturer at the Department of Visual Communication, Bezalel Academy of Arts and Design, Jerusalem, Israel. She's a political and social activist and a graphic designer. The courses she teaches combine social involvement and active social media activity, and her students produce visual communication packages for organizations and NGOs. Ruthi is the Bezalel President's Advisor also for gender fairness in Bezalel. And in her studio, she's working on a regular basis for social and environmental organizations. Ruthi, the floor is all yours. Please give us your insights.
Hi, everybody. I'm really honored to be here and to meet you all. And I'm very happy to listen to each one of you, and I learned a lot so far, so it was worth it. And I think that International Women's Day is really kind of event we should celebrate together, women from all over the world who have a common challenge. So I like this theme. When I thought about what Roshni asked, so I felt that maybe I was looking for some kind of inspiration or hope or something to deal with, and I felt that actually the area I'm coming from, my discipline, is and giving me a lot of dilemmas. So I thought maybe I'll talk about it, about my dilemmas. And because I like my discipline, and I have been teaching for many years a lot of students, and I teach them how to work modestly and in a listening mode to the needs of the society and NGOs and political movements. But then yet I felt that visual communication is the kind of transparent, or we are actually the executors. We never criticize. I want to find my way to keep teaching, learning, dealing, designing, which I like, and see what is the challenge here. Because when we talk about architecture or industrial design, it's inherent in the discipline. And visual communication, we are never blamed. We can talk about what left from what we're doing later, or how materials do we use, or does a screen solving the problems. But there are so many ethical questions in the basic definition of the discipline that this is actually what keep me going on and keep me working, designing, and finding every day the right corner. So I think that because we are the mediators, we are the people who package ideas, we are translating ideas into visual language, we're sharpening messages, we promote sales, but we are never blamed because we didn't invent the beautiful house or the new flavor of ice cream. And I feel many times not comfortable, but I'm still going on doing and hope to find the way, because the quality of the design might be judged, but not but never the deed itself, because we are part of a team, but we are collaborating with things. So I'm really trying to find my way in this. But there is one place where I find hope and inspiration, and not to be the party pooper, so I thought maybe I'll share it with you. It's a very nice place in Israel. Roshni, can I make a share screen?
Yes, you can.
Okay, how do I do it? Just a second. Share screen. Okay. And can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. And this is a place I've been working for like more than 10, maybe 15 years. This is the Center for Environmental Education, which is built on underneath a garbage dump. It used to be a Palestinian village and then developed into a garbage dump. And mostly most of the garbage from the region, the central region of Israel is getting there. And underneath this mountain, there is this educational center. You see these children coming here. So here's the mountain, which is not anymore a garbage dump. And here's the educational center. And what they do there, whenever I get there, is I feel there is hope, because they use, for example, everything that is presented there is by reuse of material. This is a disposable, very beautiful disposable items, or things that are made. I mean, so first of all, it's very, very beautifully designed. And children are getting to event that everything they are dealing with is doing by reuse or recycled materials. And there's a lot of work done there with garbage, smelling the garbage in this beautiful place. You smell all the time the smell of the garbage. But they do create children, school, elderly people, everybody's coming there. And my modest distribution for this was when I had to put the information on the wall of this place. So I understood I couldn't do it just on new things. So I did it all with reuse of recycled materials and talking about the future. And when I come there, I think there is still solutions and hopes and things that you can do, even though I'm the criminal of visual communication. So thank you very much and very glad to be here.
Thank you, Ruthi, that was amazing. Something that we could watch. Actually, in reality, you have done this. This is amazing work, both for, I think it's an excellent contribution as a designer that you have done to environmental education. And of course, Ruthi's contribution to our SIB program has been probably the most important, because she always thinks from a different dimension than the architects and the industrial designers. So it's always good to have her insights in our workshop to help us look at another dimension. Thank you so much, Ruthi. And now, not the least, we have Dr. Sadhana Mahashabde. Our acquaintance is perhaps more than 2 decades old, or maybe more, outside the arena of environment as well. But we started together probably on a public interest litigation against a major project in the city where Sadhana was a young lawyer, and I was part of the NGO which had applied for the public interest litigation, and then later a series of projects, and we have worked together over a long time, including the Dahisar River Restoration Project and many more. Dr. Sadhana Mahashabde is a practicing environmental lawyer with the Bombay High Court. She has a PhD in environmental law from Bharatiya Vidyapeeth University in Pune. Her areas of specialization include environment pollution, municipal solid waste management, coastal regulation zone, environmentally sensitive areas, National Green Tribunal, and environmental impact assessment. She has more than 20 years of experience as a lawyer at Bombay High Court, particularly having spearheaded several public interest litigations for environmental preservation in and around Mumbai city, including the Worli-Bandra Sea Link Project, the Gorai Dumping Ground, Mathiran Environment Impact Assessment, and noise pollution in Mumbai. I give the floor to you, Sadhana, to give us a brief about your work and what inspires you. Over to you, Sadhana. I think you are on mute, is it? We can't hear you.
Sadhana ma'am, we can't hear you.
Still, we cannot hear you. I think there's some problem with the audio connection in your laptop or something. Do you need to put on your earphone or something? Maybe it's plugged in. We cannot hear you yet, Sadhana. Yes, I think now it will work.
Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Happy Women's Day to all of you. Sorry for the disturbance. It's great pleasure to celebrate Women's Day with all of you, and I'm really pleased with that. As Roshini told me, I am an environment lawyer and dealing with environment matters in lower court, high court, Supreme Court, and dealing with several environmental matters, I found that basically the love for the environment and my willingness to protect and conserve the environment, I turned out to be an environmental lawyer. Basically, I did my law for the sake of to protect some my mother's property, but I could do that. Then the love towards environment took me to take over and practice, especially for my passion, that is for the environment. And then I did my PhD. I have dealt with several environment matters. As far as my personal liking is concerned, or my ability, I would say I'm a good coordinator. I can coordinate well when I'm dealing with the matters. I'm a senior counsel for Government of India. I'm a senior counsel for Maharashtra Pollution Control Board, several municipalities and all. And I deal with important matters relating to hospital waste or tree cutting matters. So then I have to coordinate with several departments, their egos, what's going on at the site in actuals, and getting information from all of them, coordinating well in timing. And there is a lot of insensitivity I could see during arguing the matter with the judges or the lawyer friends. Then without getting upset, I have to persistently keep on working hard for it. I have to get the utmost knowledge and information. I have to convince them in the way they understand it. And all that made me become a good environmental lawyer. Here I would like to put forth in one of the order, Justice Chandrachud specifically mentioned that appreciated my work and coordination and my assistance in the matter for the tree cutting. So whenever any tree is chopped off, the permission is required from the tree authority. Then what kind of precautions need to be taken? That is being given in that one of the kind order. And I believe then the coordination amongst all and studying in detail about the things can help me. And here I would like to mention that law can really help a lot in sustainable development or in conservation of environment. As we say, the law is most powerful tool. We can stop any development, we can allow any development, we can regulate the development. And in that way, it's very important tool we can work with the environment protection. Here I would like to point out that when I am dealing with the environmental legislation or environmental law, when I'm taking up any particular project, as Roshini said, we were doing with, I myself is an activist, and love towards environment brought me to become an environment lawyer. So when we do for sake of achieving some conservation, then we have to deal with several other things other than law also, or other than coordinating with when appearing for the government agencies, when we deal with the matters of the NGOs or CRZ matters. In that, we have to see actually that just before hearing 2-3 days, if we could manage to get some news in the newspaper, because judges read those newspapers. So we need to have something of that kind. So media need to be handled, lots of awareness need to be done, some kind of agitation against some project which is hazardous need to be carried out, need to have some place in media. So everything need to be managed as far as the any of the environment conservation is dealt with. One need to have a specific knowledge and information about it. Youths, as far as the sustainable development is concerned, I believe in having a knowledge about the project, deal with the media, apply for the RTI, right to information, make a complaint to the appropriate authorities. And for all that, one need to have an environment education also at place. I myself is an environmental educationist. I teach environmental education. I write in the newspapers for that. And even I am a chairperson of environment cell of one of the political party. So as we all know, political will is lacking. So whenever we have to deal with the environmental legislation, we have to deal with any of the conservation of the environment, here we need to deal with the things multifacetedly, where environmental law can really play a very, very important role. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadhana. Sadhana is also, apart from all the work she does in as a practicing lawyer in the field of environment and doing lots of public interest litigation, she's also a scholar in Hindu philosophy and the Bhagavad and so on and so many things. I love to hear her insights on all these things. You can read so many books, as you can see behind her. So maybe some other time we can hear her about all these interesting insights into the various texts that have been written in the past. So thank you so much, Sadhana, and all of you. It was fascinating to hear all of your stories. And I want to ask now, as we go into the second round, sorry, this has been a longish wait for those who finished first, but I want to ask the panelists here that given the current situation of the pandemic, the rising threat of global climate change, maybe even consumerism, consumption of resources, what do you see as a vision for the future, for a sustainable future? And how do you see yourself maybe a decade or two down the line. So I wouldn't ask the question to anybody specific. I would ask any of the six panelists to go ahead and let's keep it a little bit easy flowing for now. So anybody who wants to say about this can just go ahead. Maybe we can start with you, Anne, since nobody else has.
I think I see Anjali waving her hand.
Oh, okay. Okay, I missed that. Yes, Anjali, go
ahead. No problem. If Anne, if you want to speak first.
No, I didn't see that. Oh,
after
no,
you.
No,
go ahead. Okay. Yeah, actually, I think very often about that. That question. And I thought about, we are now around 7.77 billions of people on Earth, and till 2050, we will be more than 9 billion 70 something. So we eat, we drink, we live our lives in more or less comfort, but we use our resources, not our resources. We use the resources of the earth. And in my mind, it sounds maybe a little bit strange, but when this virus came and started to kill people, I thought maybe the earth, Mother Earth, doesn't like us any longer. It maybe sound a little bit strange and a little bit, yeah, emotional. But I think emotions have to be on Earth, especially in our industrial countries. Many things are done in the work without emotion or with the underpressed emotions. You do your work every day. Many people work like a machine, and this virus shows us how important a touch is, a hug, being near to each other, to have friends, to have family, to be involved in a circle of beloved people. So this is one point what I see when I think about a sustainable future. I don't think only about ecology or working with our resources in an absolutely other way. I also think about mankind, and that mankind has to come together. This is very, very important, that we estimate the value of each other. We support each other. We show our emphasis to each other. This is very, very important, because if we don't feel as one, that we are all one, then we will have wars and battles and conflicts and terrorism and all of that. So this is one point, first point. Second point, for sure, because this is my profession, I speak about a green future. We have to plant green. The most what is possible, because the green is the only buffer to buffer the CO2 and to buffer the O2, the moisture. Because of that, we have to plant green, so trees, shrubs, all what is possible. Make buildings green, greening of the roofs, greening of facades, and so on. And we can also combine it with third point, with saving energy. If we, for instance, combine the green roofs with photovoltaics, this is very good and very helpful, and it goes together. Many people think you can do only one of them, only PV or only green, but it comes very good together, especially in arid areas or also in Berlin. Because we have really hot summers, and the shadow of the PV creates more coolness, a little bit more moisture for the roof greening. So make all of the things green and use renewable energies. This is the third point I wanted to say. And so in my mind, if we speak about sustainability, and this is always a misunderstanding in many cases, when people speak about sustainability, they think it will be green anyhow. Yeah? But sustainability is much more. Sustainability is social, ecological, and an economic way. And if the three things come together, only then it's a really sustainable project. And this we all should understand, and especially our students or our pupils, whoever. They all should understand only if the three columns of the sustainability come together, then it really works. And last but not least, I want to speak about the water problem, because water will become the first problem in the world, in my mind. I see water is missing. Here in Berlin, we have a loss of water. It's really scary. Our rivers lose water, our lakes lose water. In my surrounding, we have lakes in the last 2 years. In the last 2 years, they lost one meter. There's a difference of minus 1 meter of the water level. So there's a huge loss of water, and also the groundwater goes down more and more. So we have a lot of challenges in water, but on the other side, we have a lot of solutions. And in a sustainable future, this is the vision, we have to take all these solutions and make them, bring them into life, bring them into work. So this is the fourth thing. I could say much more, I think, but this is enough. Thank you.
Thank you. That's wonderful. Yes, I think Sadhana wants to say.
Yeah, as far as the sustainable development is concerned and environmental legislation is concerned, I would like to draw the attention towards environment impact assessment or public hearing. So whenever, as we say, development and environment are with a conflict interest, and whenever any mega project is coming up, it's always with the big nuisance or is causing harm to our environment. And in such case, what kind of harm it can cause is being laid down in the environment impact assessment. So what impact it is causing on the environment is computed. Is feasibility study, a small report is published. People need to read that, study that, and the public hearing is being held. It need to be attended. So as we all are saying, in coming future, we are in the need of development, but to have it in a sustainable manner, the role of the government and every citizens is also increasing, and we need to be more and more aware and see that even the implementation, everything is being now online and published in the gazette. So one, as far as the youth is concerned, every citizen is concerned, should be aware of what is permissible, what are the limits, if anything wrong, they feel like they have to go it in detail and find the reason, make an RTI, make to the pollution control board complain, any small complaint given to the that authority or making it in media. So that awareness of citizens to protect and conserve their environment is, I think, multifolded, is increased, and any help relating to their understanding is available. In today's media and internet world, all the information, all online consents, everything is available. One need to have the will, and I think this is the high time that all should be very cautious about what's going on and around you, and take and stand and action for it. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I can see the synergies between what Anjali has said and what you have said as well, because people generally tend to think that either nothing is going to happen, whatever I do, you know, they are anyway going to make into a mega project or something. But every small effort that one can do must be, you know, if everybody does it, then there is at least an awareness that there is, everybody is aware of the issues and they want something else than what you are actually doing. So I think that's a good message. I look at others. Anybody else? Yes, Anne.
Very practical to add to what others have already said, but some very practical insights that we're all aware of, but I think that they bear speaking out loud on International Women's Day. The built landscape, there are so many opportunities to promote real and very, very substantial, for instance, climate gains, simply by retrofitting the existing built landscape and making sure that what we build into the future is ecologically efficient. This is why, Roshni, your work has inspired me now for so long, and the work of all the environmental architects, planners, and designers who are trying in real time to convert our built landscape to something that can survive as the human habitat, right, of the future. So, you know, I spoke earlier about building bridges in a social sense. We must also build our infrastructure with climate in mind. This, as I say, it's something we're all aware of, but we must say it out loud. And Sanjivani's work is so important for all of us to remember that environmental education is critical. There should be no year, in my view, when a child is in school that they are not also learning about ecology and the way that ecology and society are connected. Practical things, the infrastructure we live within and the way that we educate ourselves and our youth. These, I think, are critical.
Yes. Thanks, Anne. I just recollected a piece of advice that somebody gave on another panel discussion I was in some time back. She said she was herself an architect, and she said, architects need to stop building. and then what do they do? You know, the questions were coming when, you know, there's a lot to do. They can, you know, sort of repair buildings, retrofit buildings, make those buildings climate sensitive, renewable energy you can add, and so many other things, rainwater harvesting, what Anjali is doing. So a lot of things can be done. People always think that we need to build more in order to do something more. But I think the thought needs to be gone into how to make whatever is there already at least sustainable or reduce the impact on the environment. Let's see if, yes, Sanjeevni is yes, there. Yes, go ahead, Sanjeevni.
So, like, I was just thinking about this vision that you had asked, and for me, like, the vision for a sustainable future is actually a time when humans collectively make informed choices to ensure this there is a sustainable life on Earth. And I think, like, it is only possible when we put value on real resources, like natural resources and human values of good health and well-being and a sense of community. You know, like progressing and evolving as intelligent species that is keen on maintaining this balance of the Earth's biodiversity and ecosystems. Because often we don't realize in the huff and puff of this modern world that that actually money, for which there is like the most of the degradation is happening, money is actually something we created as a resource, and its value is only what we collectively believe in, and we've put that value on it. So the minute we realize collectively that this is not the resource that we would like to sacrifice our well-being along with the planet's, I think it will be very easy to make a transition into transition from that linear economy, which is like taking so much from the earth and not giving back, to a circular economy. And as you mentioned in my introduction, I'm a big advocate and a believer in for circular economy. And I think like the sustainable future is only possible when we make this transition collectively as a species. And especially if anything COVID-19 has shown us, it is actually how disconnected we are from the actual truth of life, how disconnected we are from nature, and how much we need this connection. We all realize that we cannot survive in confinements, and in confinements which would have been luxurious for some, but otherwise also, like we cannot live with disconnected from each other. And one of the most important collaboration that we need from across the world is to put focus on education, like she said, the last 20 years, I just would like to end with an example. The last 20 years in Nepal, we had integrated a subject called environmental population and health in Nepal. And now 20 years down the line, we see new entrepreneurs making green businesses, establishing green businesses in Nepal. So I just feel like this is something we can really focus on, because in education, we are not only nurturing future scientists, but we are nurturing, future politicians and leaders and bureaucrats, and everybody should be understanding this issue and making this transition together. And the collaboration becomes natural and not forced. So this, I believe, is the vision for a sustainable life on Earth.
Thanks, Sanjeevani. I think, again, the human values that you talked about, a very, very important message there about what people value the most today, especially the younger generation or people who are, everybody wants to make more money. What is important is success. And in the whole bargain, something is left out. And those are the human values that you talked about, that Anjali talked about, which is what we need to, collectively, how can people collectively think about sustainability, about all of these values is really important. I think among the panelists now, Ruthi and Chembo are, yes, Chembo.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so for me, I think sustainability broadly looks at the prudent utilization of resources to allow future generations to have access. And then also it looks at, a balance. So that's the human race coexisting with the surrounding environment and ensuring that there is a balance amongst economics, the environment, as well as social aspects. But I think bringing it home for me, it also lies in the three basic R's. We have to reduce as much waste, reuse what you can, recycle as much as you can. And then also very practical aspects, plant a tree, because this is obviously the first line of defense in combating climate change. And then the use of available resources as well, local resources, use technologies that are efficient and that will obviously utilize resources that are available. And then going forward also, 20 years from now, many years from now, I would also want to remember myself as having been a person that took part in a positive change. There's so many things going on, but I think let's each make positive strides to achieve a common goal. And then with with the COVID-19 pandemic, I think it has also helped me realize that for you to achieve a common goal, you need to work together. Yeah, thanks.
Yes, thank you. I think all of the ideas that are being expressed have a common message about, I think we need to constantly think about how we are going to be part of this whole change. We have to visualize that change and we have to become part of it. And I think we have a wonderful group of people here who can probably, you know, be the leaders for a lot of other people around the world. Let me check if Ruthi has, yes, Ruthi.
To what Jeff just said, because I really think this is the era of collaboration. I think you cannot achieve anything by being in one discipline or in one perspective, and only understanding that we need all the areas, lawyers and agriculture, scientists, education people. I mean, this is the era of collaboration and multidisciplinary attitude, because we will not be able to do it in one perspective. And I think that when the COVID-19 started, I felt that we need, this is a time to restart, like a time to reconsider and refresh every belief and every way we live. And I really, really hope that something will change. I'm not sure my hope has achieved, but I felt that capitalism can come to, I don't know if to its end, but to a new way of understanding what is a profit. And I think one of the engines behind everything we are trying to change is the strength of capitalism. And I think that if nowadays capitalistic power will understand that the way they can profit, or the way they can get to the community or make a social change, is not only by selling more and giving high prices, producing more and more items, products, buildings, etc., but maybe understand that they can profit from a different attitude. So I guess that if we can get to an era of post-capitalism, or a little bit post-capitalism, by understanding the new values. And maybe there is a chance now. I'm not sure we were strong enough on our guard nowadays, but I think that multidisciplinary and post-capitalism are two things that if we could have achieved, it can happen. I think there is this very optimistic film, I forgot now his name, about agriculture in US. Have you seen it? It's Love Your Mother.
Tomorrow. Yes.
Something like this. And the idea of, for example, giving, changing the agriculture system into an organic way that not, you don't only grow corn or soybeans, etc., but you change your agriculture every year, and you, the whole attitude to, I think it's love your earth or love your mother or something like this. And you see how simple it is that the government, instead of giving money to all these diseases of agriculture, can just, even with less money and with education and with desire, it very easily can be changed. I think we should be very much aware, each one of us, in what we are doing. How can we just transist or transfer all the powers into something that can be more positive or can motivate other people to make a change?
Thank you. I think I just want to add to all the points that have been said, and especially what Ruthi has said. Recently, I was in the village, staying in, away from Mumbai, in a small village. And suddenly I realized that there, all the houses, they're so interdependent. everybody is like, if you're cooking something, everybody else in the neighborhood knows what you're cooking. And then everything is just so easy. Like there's an exchange system, there's a barter. You give rice, they give you something else. It just works without any money, actually. You know, what Sanjeevni talked about and what you are talking about, a post-capitalist sort of value system. So I think we perhaps also need to look at maybe our history and our past, and some of these things sort of worked, wherein we didn't really need a lot of money to be happy. We just had a very good social environment, economic environment as well, which was really working. So maybe we need to relook at that. So coming on to the next question that I had for all the panelists was, if you want to give a message to the youth or to the people at large, what would be your maybe one-liner or one kind of a message about what should people do, or what is a sort of message from you for all the youth? We can have a quick round from everyone. Yes, Anjali.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I want to make it very short. I thought about what is in my mind when it comes to bring it to young people. And I thought the first is improve your knowledge. Learn to know your nature and learn to love it and respect it. Be open to any peaceful living, to any peaceful other people. Cooperate. Don't eat meat. Reduce your meat. Reduce your consumption. And work interdisciplinary. Mm-hmm. You can add more. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. I'm just writing down all of these points so I can just put them together. Yes, I cannot see everybody all together, so I have to keep moving this. So please, anybody else who wants to add to what Anjali has said? Yes, Sadhna.
I would like to add to what Anjali said, is that the dumping ground issue or the municipal solid waste issue is an very big issue faced by urban areas. And in that respect, 3R, that is reduce, reuse and recycle, or segregate the wet and dry garbage and try to reuse or use the wet garbage for composting and segregating and zero garbage kind of thing. And the issue of dumping ground is becoming such a big issue, and which can be solved only by participation of individual citizens. And if youth take an important role in it, I think only that issue can be tackled. So this issue relating to garbage and the Trisutri, that is reduce, reuse and recycle, for the garbage issue should also be look into it. That I would like to add. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadhna. Yes, Chembo.
Okay, so my message to the youth would be, identify your passion, incline towards it. Work towards it, towards this passion, and let any opportunity find you ready. And then away from academics, let's sharpen our skills. You know, there's so many things that scientists can't write, and yet very good journals, articles, and papers are actually from the science world as well. So let's defy some of these things. Then once you're settled, create a brand, network, and grow. Yeah, and go green as well.
Yes, thanks, Jembo. Anybody else wants to give a message?
I can go.
Yes, Sanjeevani.
Yes. So I, when I saw this question, I was just thinking about, like, you know, what it felt being a young person, what I felt when I was a young person. And I just realized that, you know, it's the voice of youth is so powerful. And when you are young, your conviction is undiluted, your points of views are very strong, and your principles are uncompromised. So I just want all the youth to be brave and be positive, be just, and be the change you want to see in the world. Because there'll be many people like us who will support you. And like the previous Chembu, what just she mentioned about finding the passion, I would like to urge everyone to find that passion, which is not only bringing you joy, but actually it brings joy and well-being to your community and your to your environment also. And yes, and choose the path to sustainability, no matter what your profession is. So that would be my
great. Thank you, Sanjeevani. And there's Anne. Yes.
I would say it very concisely, turn to one another, not away from one another. It is so important, again, to build bridges across what is unfamiliar. Everything depends on it. All of our scientific knowledge, if we are to operationalize it, we must turn to one another.
Wow. I think I can create a whole charter out of all the messages that I have got from you guys. Thank you so much. I think now Ruthi has not spoken. Would you like to give a message?
I would like to add to what all of you have said, and I think that we should educate them to think, to ask things, to plan, and to recheck all the perspective we give them, because we understand that it kind of fades. So I think that refusing is not just refusing to be a consumption society, but refuse to go this way, to be modest, to say no to so many things, to ask themselves, do I really need this and this and this? And now I'm talking about the Western society, but all over the world, what are the ideas? Is this, as I said before, is this capitalistic vision is the one that we need to serve? So I think by look at them to choose, to think, to repair things, to ask questions, and to really be critical about everything we help them to believe in, and maybe they can lead us to make the change. Because whenever I go to do my shopping, I see, I mean, nowadays it's changed, but I remember like 10 years ago, it's the children who told their parents not to grab all these plastic bags. So isn't just because the teacher told them that you can do it differently. So it's kind of easy to give ideas, but you have to educate them to be independent and to ask and to check and rethink about everything we educate them to.
Thank you everyone. I think we have a wonderful set of ideas. Maybe we can put all this together and see where we can take it. And now for the last question of the session today, it's a little bit challenging, and you all need to probably think a little bit more. And the question is about how can we collaborate, all of us here. I know that individually you're all making a difference in your own space, but can we see some synergies here amongst us? And would you want to suggest some kind of a collaboration so that we can continue this discussion forward, maybe in wherever we are or together, you know, maybe we create something. So that's an open question again to all the panelists. Yes, Sadhna.
Hi, as we say, environment is everything around us, and to conserve and protect the environment, we need a multifaceted kind of efforts. And in that, as I have been saying, that judiciary, administration, legislation, at every stage, there is a lack of sensitivity about the environment, or lack of political will is there due to, as we say, whenever the we thought of having implementation of environmental legislation, either your profit is coming down or your time for the production is increasing. So it is not in the benefit of production or a developer or so, even though you can hear it nice to have, but when practically you see the environmental mental legislation is not supporting the development. And in that respect, there is a lack of political will. So considering lack of political will, we need to have a multifaceted pressures for the enforcement of environmental legislation. Here I would like to point out even the international legislation, because international covenants or summits are taking place from time to time, and the country who is signatory to it and committing something to it are answerable internationally, then the lack of political will or the enforcement of environmental legislation, this kind of especially international pressures can move. I would like to give an example. In as we say, Rio de Janeiro bought the sustainable future in 1992. And every 5 years, every country is reporting to it. So in India, when in 2012, we promised to have a special legislation, special green codes and all to have in India. But the political will was lacking. So we could find that in 2011, we had the NGT Act, or we had environmental codes at place, because we are ultimately answerable internationally. So the these kind of multifaceted efforts, collaboratively working for it, does matter. CFC is concerned, or ozone depleting substances is one of the important legislation we could find, which is having a internationally standards are given and the enforcement category is given. We could see that took place really very well. So that international collaborative action is really very important. R&D is also very important, of course, along with awareness and every citizen's work. These international platforms and the collaborative work international can really help in conserving the environment.
Thanks, Sadhna. My question was a little bit more towards what we, that is, you know, 6-7 of us who are there, we can do together. So I think if we can focus on that, of course, whatever you have also said can be sort of put into the same, you know, we can put it into that framework. But okay. I would like you all to give me an idea of how we can do something together. Maybe it's not possible now. Maybe we can continue the dialogue offline on emails. Great. Yes, Anne.
Just a quick and practical suggestion. So I teach environmental studies at New York University, and the university is a wonderful place to dream up collaborative projects and propose them, and you know, try to find resources that actualize them. I convene an interdisciplinary lab group. Right now, it is all women. It's called the Urban Greening Lab. And I would invite any of you with interest to please get in touch with me And through the Urban Greening Lab, we can work together to ask questions, investigate as interdisciplinary teams, and make the change that we've been talking about now together. I also would just say very quickly, I saw examples constantly, Roshni, through your work, examples constantly of how to collaborate. If you're looking for good examples, look no further than Rachna Sansad Institute for Environmental Architecture. She is a master collaborator, my deep inspiration. And I hope very much, Roshni, to work with you again via the Urban Greening Lab or through Rachna Sansad or through some other way. So universities, they're a great place to collaborate.
Yeah, I think we can all cook up a project together and work on it. That would be really wonderful. Any other ideas? Anybody else wants to say anything? Yes, Chembo.
Well, tough to actually think of what could be done right now, but I think for me, this platform is already one example of very good collaboration and genuine networks. I mean, I met Roshni, as was earlier mentioned, in 2018, but here we are collaborating on a whole different platform. So I think my take is for us to continue with the genuine connections and ensure that, you know, each of us is probably just a call or an email away from the next person that is in need of information. Of course, we realize certain information cannot just be given there and then, but at least we can guide on how that information can officially be given. And then also, over and above, women are more in number and we are more on the ground. So for me, I think that's already a greater way to make an impact here. So let's continue with the networks.
Thank you, Chembu. I think that's very true that the connections are genuine and everybody is being so natural about, and we've all already connected. And you all are also connected by emails. So whenever any one of us can think of something, we are all, you know, we can form a group and do something together. Thank you so much, Chembu. Sanjeevni, yes.
I found this today's discourse very, very powerful. I learned so much and I was already making plans in my head to, you know, reach out so that I could learn about designing green landscapes to Anne's project and the ecos, like the center that Roti has made. So there's so many things that we can actually, I as an individual, and I can learn also and apply it to my work. So I was also thinking, like, if we can also extend this conversation further, and probably, like, this was like more just getting to know each other, but there's so much more that we can also share, also as share the indigenous knowledges that we have from our countries, also share it in this platform, stories of inspiring women in current time and place, things like that. I think these would be very, very amazing collaborations to start off with.
Yes, thank you. I think that's true. I mean, each one of us, we have seen something of what the other is doing. And that itself is a starting point. And that gives us an idea that we can do something like this over here. And maybe, you know, you can take the help of Ruthie to do something like that in Nepal, or, you know, about the river in you know, what Anne has done and her monumental work on the Bagmati can be utilized. So, you know, there are lots of interconnections which we can take forward. Thank you so much, Sanjeevni. And let me see, Anjali. Sorry. Yes. Is anybody raised hand? Okay, yes.
I was ready.
okay.
Yeah. Actually, I see a collaboration, possibility of collaboration with everybody of you, because all the things you speak about, I dealt with in my profession. I'm serious. All of you got a special matter which more or less directly influences my work, my daily work, you know. So If you speak, for instance, about the laws in about ecology laws, I also deal a lot with the law about cutting trees, for instance. We also have that. Yeah. If you speak about that, this is very. I know it very well. So also the process, the discussing process. So how to make the law, or about energy saving. There is so much to collaborate in my mind. And I have to tell you something. It's because it's so crazy that I meet you here in the panel, because you are from New York, and in 2011, you know what happened then, yeah, 9/11. I was invited on the 10th October to New York City to held lectures at three universities, and one of them was your university. No, not 10th October, I'm sorry. After the, yes, 10th October, 9/11, 10th October. Then this happened and I didn't fly there because this time was so, yeah, I can't describe it. You know it, you know what happened. To see you now, this is really amazing because you come from there and it's like a circle, you know? So the last piece of a circle is now round. It's really, really amazing. I would like to cooperate with all of you. I'm open for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ruthie, yes.
First of all, I think we've done the first step. Thanks to you, Roshni. We are here. We shared our knowledge, our perspective, and I'm really empowered by this. And I think we can use this inside of networking. We can be a group of solidarity. Because I think in each place there are some kind of, you know, struggles, social and economical and ecological disasters and things that we know from our, you know, in our small circles. Like in Israel just now, there was a terrible disaster on the beach with a really terrible thing of sea pollution and really a crime. And I don't know if everybody knows, so we can share solidarity and ecological struggles, etc. And also I think that we can collaborate on courses and on via universities, but you know, invite each other to speak about things in our courses. And Roshni, I think that maybe this year in Small is Beautiful, we can invite you, and maybe one of your countries can join our project, because Small is Beautiful is relevant all over the world, because we are learning from people who live in small places and crowded places. What can we learn from them that can be adapted all over the world? So you are the world, so we can join you. And also I have a vision that like next year on the same day of International Women's Day, we can celebrate the same platform, but each one of us will invite one, two or three students or activists, other women, that we can enlarge the circle and have this kind of an annual meeting that will grow. Mm-hmm. So we can meet you in a year from now. And between these days, we can really start collaborating. And I trust Roshni to be the engine here and to I really, amazing how you gathered all this wonderful women. So I trust you to continue.
Yes, okay. I think one of my skills is to be a good network. I do very well, and I like to connect with people whom I connect well. So all of you are people whom I really have touched me in one way or the other. So thank you so much. I think with what all of you have said in the end, I take what Anne said about the Urban Greening Lab
We'll take what Ruthi has said about the SIBs. Certainly, we would want all of you to be invited and to participate in that. Maybe we can do it from one country to the other, so we can take it different places. That would be amazing. So, and of course, the last part that Ruthi said about meeting next year, and making our group larger. Already, I was just looking at the gallery view on my Zoom, and I was seeing so many women here. I'm sure all of them are in their own way, have contributed in one way or the other, and that's why they're here listening to all of us. And there are lots of messages. Of course, you can all see the chat box and see all the messages that have been pouring through. And they all admire you. All the messages that you have given have been so meaningful to them. Thank you so much. And now we have, we have announced the Women in Sustainability Award. This is the first year within a very short time we asked for entries, and we want to make it a bigger thing in the future. But to announce the winners of the Women Leaders in Sustainability, I will invite Dr. Shashidhar Kashyap, who is the treasurer of IEAR, and he will announce the winners. Dr. Kashyap?
Yeah, thank you. You can hear me, no?
Yes.
Okay. after listening to all the panelists, I think I am also getting inspired. Now, we had called for entries for this Women Leaders in Sustainability Award, and we had a number of entries. Each one of them were in their own right very good, and we had a difficult time trying to assess. But of course, the end has to come somewhere, and we based our decisions on four factors. The first one is importance and impact. The second one was scale up and replicability. The third one was long-term commitment, and the fourth was innovation. So under these headings, we rated all the entries that we had got. And I am happy to announce that the winner in the Distinguished Environment Professional category is none other than architect Trupti Doshi. I think Roshni knows her very well and her work in Auroville. And she is the first winner in this category. In the second category, the budding environmentalist, we have Ms. Surubhi Balavalkar. Okay, that is Trupti Doshi's citation and certificate. The second one is Ms. Surubhi Balavalkar as a budding environmentalist. She works for the NGO and she's done a lot of good work. Yes, there is details about Ms. Balavalkar.
Dr. Kashyap, let me just intervene.
You want to read it out?
No, I think she has sent her a small message by video. A 1 minute video. So I request Naida, if possible, to play that video.
Okay.
The volume is not there.
Institute of Environmental Architecture, and I'm extremely honored to be receiving the Budding Environmentalist Award. I sincerely thank Institute of Environmental Architecture and Research. I will certainly keep working in the field of environment and sustainability. Thank you very much once again. Wish you all a very happy Women's Day. Thank you.
Yes, thanks.
Yeah, I'll continue. Yeah, and yes. And then looking at the entries that we had, we found one entry of Ms. Priyanka Narula, who worked on the Vicker story, that is bamboo and its products. We thought it would be a good thing to...
I would like...
Hello.
Yes.
we thought that we should create a new category of a promising innovator, because this is something different. And all these people who have won today, I feel that they have done a lot of altruistic work, and I think that should get carried forward. I have a few things to say with regard to whatever I've heard today. Yeah, that is the weaker story of Ms. Narula.
Do we have her video as well, Naida? You can play it. You can play it now.
Hello. I would like to thank the IEAR and Women in Sustainability Awards for extending this platform for us young designers and entrepreneurs, and for celebrating women in sustainability. This award comes at a time when sustainability is the need of the hour. It boosts the morale to keep giving our best and driving conscious innovation further. I would also like to extend my gratitude towards the jury members for understanding our project and the love for craft behind them.
Thank you.
Shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. After looking at the weaker story, I felt that, of course, this is still my personal opinion, that we should have something called an innovation incubator, which we could think of considering with IEAR members as well as the panelists that we have today, who have gladly agreed to collaborate with us. So we can have a brainstorming session and see how the innovation incubator works. Let me take the example of bamboo itself. Use of bamboo in its various forms in present day architecture or in maybe other sustainable ideas. That is what we could look at. And now if you see that there are a lot of rating systems for the built environment, which actually motivates and encourages architects and designers to think green. Of course, this has been mentioned by all our panelists as they discussed. And why not add a new dimension by using materials like bamboo for, say, inner non-load-bearing walls? Suppose we say we've got this today's built environment, modern buildings in so many forms. Can't we use that? Because if you look at bamboo itself, it is a fast-growing plant. And in 1 hectare or 10,000 square meters of land, you could sequester as much as 17 tons of carbon. So it's a fast-growing. It can be reused. That means you can grow again and again. Maybe every 3 to 5 years, you use the same land to produce more bamboo, and more carbon gets sequestered. And now suppose you say that I am using this bamboo in some form in the built environment. It is going to stay there as carbon and is not going to be released in the atmosphere. Maybe that will help in mitigating climate change. It's an interesting thing that we should look at. And now if we say, okay, we have an innovation incubator, people could come out with different ideas and we could encourage these ideas. So suppose we say we get a lot of people with ideas this year. So 2021, 22, people work on ideas. And in the Women's Day of 2022, we bring forward the best of ideas and see how to take it forward and go in for a sustainable environment. Everybody has talked about sustainable environment. What I feel is that if you look at new materials and if you can use that in the best forms that are available, and in the best ways that we can think of, I think climate change could be reduced to a large extent. The CO2 could be brought down and maybe the environment can become better and better. So I think this, whoever is listening to us today and whoever will listen to this clipping in the future should get encouraged and motivated to become active in this sphere and contribute to a better environment for tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kashyap. I would now like to take a moment to introduce the strongest pillar behind the Institute, our President, Dr. Roshni Udyavar Yehuda. She's an inspiration to me and many more in the field of environment. Dr. Roshni Udyavar Yehuda is a practicing architect and academician whose core competency lies in energy efficient and environmental design of buildings. She has a PhD in resource management and is a qualified master trainer and empaneled expert on the Energy Conservation Building Code of India, awarded by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency in February 2015. She is a trainer for SUSTAMI, Sustainable Education Academy Australia, co-chairman ASSOCHAM GEM Maharashtra chapter, director of Roshni Udyavar and Associates Mumbai, and advisor Environment and Sustainability, Science and Technology Park Pune. Dr. Roshni is a principal investigator for the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India's research project on developing energy efficient and ECBC compliant opaque wall assembly. She was head Rachna Sansad Institute of Environmental Architecture from June 2003 to July 2017, where she initiated several environmental projects in addition to a postgraduate course on environmental architecture. She has more than 20 years of academic and professional experience and has traveled widely on professional assignments to more than 20 countries. Dr. Roshni's efforts has made this event possible by coordinating with a versatile group of women from all over the world. I would like to thank our speakers, Dr. Annie Ratmaker, Ms. Sanjeevni Yonzon, Ms. Chembo Sichinga, Ms. Anjali Butner, Professor Ruthi Kantor, and Dr. Sadhana Bhashabde for their availability and especially because of the different time zones they all belong to. All of them have made this event a successful one by celebrating this day with us and sharing their work, which I'm sure has impacted each and everyone here. I would also like to congratulate the award winners and extend best wishes on behalf of the Institute. We will be back with our next webinar, which is on valuing our water resources on World Water Day on 22nd of March, 2021. We have an interesting lineup of speakers for a full day event. Announcements on the same will be made on our social media pages. Do share this with our friends and colleagues. We would like to thank all who are a part of our virtual family on Instagram and Facebook and are making us stronger with your support. If you're not yet a part, do follow our Instagram and Facebook page for further updates. The link to join our pages have been posted in the chat window. Also, subscribe to our YouTube page and do check out past webinars. We have covered more than 17 webinars till now on varied topics. We will also be soon announcing our short certificate courses and training modules, so stay tuned. Thank you all for joining today. Take care and stay safe. Bye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Maybe we should take a picture.
Yes.
Already maybe it's a little bit too late.
I sent you. I took one. I put it in the chat. Just a second.
Okay. I also took some, so I can also put it later on. I can share it with everyone.
I can do it. I put it here in the chat. Just a second. Just did it.
Bye.
Here it is. So it's from the last session with you, Dr. Kashyap.
Yeah.
And all of us.
Okay.
Is Anne still online?
Okay, it is.
I think she had to go for a class.
It's coming up. I put it in the chat. It's a screenshot, just okay. A moment. Taking some time, but you soon will have it.
So, okay.
I'll tell you when it's done. Now.
Yes, I think yes.
Okay.
I'll save the chat.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Thank you.
See you all.
Bye.
All right.